Hello everyone, I'm Jens van der Plas and I'm going to present the paper Incremental Flow Analysis Through Computational Dependency Reification. Now, I will first start by briefly introducing static analysis. So what is a static analysis? Well, it's an analysis that tries to compute a certain program property without actually running the program. An example of such a property is a control flow graph. So suppose we have our little program on the right here where a function computes a Fibonacci, which is called inside the loop. Then the static analysis could, for example, infer this control flow graph on the left. Now, importantly, such problems are in general undecidable, and therefore the static analysis will approximate the actual solution. Often, a requirement of such analysis is that they produce results fast, and for this reason, they can be integrated in IDEs and RCI systems, for example, where they are actually expected by developers. Also, it has been shown that fast analysis results lead to a better developer response. And to get a faster results, you can use an incremental analysis. And this kind of analysis will, upon a change in the program, not just throw away all previous analysis results, but update and the previously computed results and reuse them. So what I'm presenting to you today is a general approach that can be used to render an existing modular analysis incremental. And our approach is aimed at dynamically typed higher order languages, so we do not require statically known call graphs, for example. Now, what is a modular analysis? Well, a modular analysis is an analysis that decomposes a program into parts. And these parts we call modules. They can be functions or threads or some files, whatever. So suppose we again have our little example program, we can see that we can divide it in three functions. And also the entry point can be looked at as a kind of main function. Now, when a program is analyzed, the modular analysis will approximate the runtime equivalents of these modules, and this is what we call components. And for example, the runtime equivalent of a function is a function call. And the analysis will analyze these components in isolation. Now, a component contains the module, but can also contain some extra contextual information to distinguish it from other components. And this can, for example, be the call site or arguments to a function. And when more contextual information is used, more components can be distinguished and the analysis becomes more precise. So for example, suppose we would use the call site to distinguish components, then for our little program on the right, the modular analysis will create these components, and I've put arrows to show how functions are called by the program. Now, let's briefly first look at how the analysis works. Well, the analysis always starts by analyzing the main program, main component, and this corresponds to the entry point of the program. So when this main component is analyzed, the analysis finds a call to fib5 and creates a new component for this. Then in the second step, the analysis will analyze this component and find two more calls to fib. But as these calls are at a different call site, and in this example, this call site is used as contextual information, two more components are found. And the analysis will then analyze them one after the other until no more components are found. So importantly, a component can be analyzed multiple times. For example, if the return value of this component fib-n1 is updated, and the two dependent components here on the right need to be reanalyzed to take into account this return value. And therefore, a modular analysis is actually dependency driven. So what are these dependencies? Well, there can be various dependencies between components. If we look at our little program here, we see that arguments are passed, return values are read, and also functions can use shared data structures, for example. And as a result of these dependencies within the program, there will also be dependencies between the components. And in modular analysis, these dependencies are reified and used to drive the analysis. So let's look at our little program again. Then we see that there are many, many dependencies. And we find that these dependencies can actually be used to incrementalize the modular analysis. For an incremental analysis, we of course need to be able to represent changes to a program. And for this, we have introduced a kind of change expression, which can be added by a change distiller or CI system, for example, but also manually. So suppose we look at our FIP program and, oh no, we see that we have made an error in the end condition. So instead of equals n zero, we want to say n has to be smaller than two. Then we can add this small change expression to denote this change. So suppose we have made a change and the analysis infers that almost all variables in the program are integers except for FIP with a closure. And additionally, the analysis has inferred a set of components and dependencies, and for every component, a return value. Then the analysis will, then a developer makes a change to the program. So instead of returning an integer, the developer converts it to a real in scheme. And so the analysis will analyze the directly affected components, which will cause the return values for these components to be updated. And also the analysis finds that now these two variables are also real. But as updates are monotonic, the analysis cannot discard outdated results. And for this, a bit of precision is lost, since the analysis now thinks these can be both integers and reals, while in the new program, this can only be reals. Now, then the modular analysis will use its dependencies to see whether other components are also affected. And indeed, it finds that the return value of main also needs to be updated. So it will reanalyze main because its return value is dependent on the return value of FIP5. And importantly, only affected and both directly and indirectly affected components will be updated and reanalyzed, but no other components. So let's say this a bit more formally. So there are two steps. In step one, there is a need to be a change impact calculation where the analysis has to compute the directly affected components. To do so, during the analysis of a component, the analysis will have to track which expressions are encountered there. And then when an expression is changed, we can look up the expressions in, for example, in a map and find the directly affected components. In step two, these components are added to the worklist of the intercomponent analysis, and this intercomponent analysis can then be restarted. And due to the dependencies, also transitively dependent components will be reanalyzed. Now, it's important to say that this technique doesn't care about the fixed call graph. What I mean, if the call graph is updated, this technique will be accounting for that. So a modular analysis can actually be very general. Up till now, we have mostly divided the program into functions, the little example program, but also the program can be divided into threads or files, for example. And we have created two instantiations, a function modular analysis and a thread modular analysis. And we have made them both context insensitive. So for every function or thread, there will be one component, but other sensitivities are readily supported as well. So then we have evaluated the approach using six metrics, of which I will discuss two. And for this, we have used 16 benchmark programs, six for a function modular analysis and nine for a thread modular analysis. And we have manually applied changes to these programs and these vary. For example, here you see a fragment of a benchmark program in which we have abstracted common functionality into a function and then replaced this functionality by a function call throughout the program. So the first thing we evaluate is the analysis time. So we compare the time needed by a full reanalysis to the time needed by an incremental update, and we see that on all but two programs the time is less, with reductions of up to 99%. We find a slowdown on two benchmarks because of the way our analysis treats pointers, which is not very efficient in our implementation at all. Then a second thing we evaluate is the precision, because like I said, the analysis cannot invalidate our data results, as analysis results are updated monotonically, and therefore the analysis may lose a bit of precision over time. So we have looked at the value store that the analysis computes, and we have compared the result of an incremental update to that of a full recomputation. And we see that on almost all programs, the result in the difference in precision is very small to none. However, on some programs, we see that there are is a bit bigger difference, which can come to the fact that outdated results cannot be discarded, or like I said, that our analysis cannot efficiently treat pointers. As is, for example, the case here with multiple dwelling cores. Now, this can be remedied by just performing a full reanalysis from time to time. So to finish this presentation, I have come up with two questions. First, I wonder how much variance is acceptable for the reduction of the analysis time. As you can see, the reductions we find are in a quite big interval, so is this acceptable or not? And second, what is the best way for us to obtain changes that we can use for the evaluation of our analysis? For example, would the audience be willing to accept the installation of a change logger in their IDE that can record their changes? And on this note, I finish my presentation. Thank you all for listening.